and welcome to the curtain raiser for GLF London at the British Library, presented in partnership with the Aga Khan Foundation UK. For the past 6 years, we have gathered in London to celebrate words, listen to brilliant conversations, and reconnect with so many of our wonderful friends, till COVID brought our lives to a screeching halt. But hey, where there's a will, there is a way. And as you couldn't come to us at the British Library, we decided that we would stream straight through to you wherever you may be. Please join me in welcoming our festival directors, Namita Gokhale and William Dalrymple.
Dear friends, we truly treasure our JLF London editions at the British Library, and we are delighted to present them in an engaging and interactive digital format. Our collaboration has been full of learnings and synergies, and I'm there in spirit with the British Library team for this run-up for our September festival. The early amphibians learned to evolve and adapt as they moved cautiously from water to land. We too are learning to cross over to virtual spaces to augment our physical and material ones. It's a journey that the pandemic has pushed us to. I'm curious to see where the accelerations and technology take us. But whatever the platform, storytellers remain the custodians of our collective memories. The sanctity of the word remains the enduring foundation of human culture and civilization. The British Library itself stands testament to the power of words and narratives, of archives and textual knowledge. The ability to name and interpret, the capacity to transmit learnings about ourselves and our environment has enabled the evolution of our species. So I'm truly looking forward to listening in to filmmaker Meera Nair as she talks to festival director Sanjoy Roy about the vocabulary of cinema and her career from her iconic debut film, Salaam Bombay, all the way to Vikram Seth's Suitable Boy. JLF festival favorite Peter Frankopan will speak of the Silk Roads with my co-director, William Dalrymple. Then, on Sunday, Nobel laureate Venki Ramakrishnan will be in conversation with director of the Science Museum, Roger Highfield, on how to follow the science through the confusions and the contradictions of our time. I'm also looking forward to speaking to the director of the Nehru Center London and mega-selling author, Amish Tripathi, on myth and memory and India's living epics. Do view these wonderful sessions that we have lined up for the 6th and 7th of June and share in the depth and intimacy of these very special conversations. Thank you for being with us. Namaste.
Hello, my name is William Dalrymple. I am one of the co-directors and co-founders of the Jaipur Literature Festival, and it's my huge pleasure to invite you to JLF London 2020. Sadly, of course, this is going to be online rather than live this year, but it's still brings me huge pleasure to bring together the two streams of my writing life. I've lived half my life in London, working in the British Library, researching all my four company and mogul books there, and obviously live in Delhi and Jaipur. And to bring these two bits of my life together is one of the great pleasures of the year. This is always a favorite week, bringing people like Peter Frankopan, one of Britain's greatest historians, into confluence with a filmmaker like Meera Nair, or a great Nobel Prize winner like our great favorite, Venki. So welcome to this fantastic event. We'll be back with a full program in September, but for the moment, this is an all-star curtain raiser, and we hope you enjoy. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Namita. Thank you, William. The British Library has been the much-loved home for JLF London over the past few years. Please welcome Rolly Keating, the Chief Executive of the British Library.
Hi, everybody. I'm Rolly Keating. I'm Chief Executive at the British Library. And warm greetings to you all from a sadly empty library building. The building may be closed, but we, though, are proudly open for business, for conversation, for partnership, and none more so than with our great friends Namita, William, Sanjoy, and the whole team at Jaipur Literary Festival, with whom we are delighted once again to be partnering on JLF in London this weekend in a little bit of a taster session, a special weekend with just a sample of some of the digital talks, and conversations so characteristic of this wonderful international festival that so reflects both global conversations and the amazing collections we hold here. So please do enjoy the weekend. We are very, very proud to be a virtual part of it. And we're looking forward also a little bit later in the year, in September, to be co-hosting with JLF an even richer sample and selection of talks then. So we hope, as well as enjoying what happens now, you'll be back with us then. But for now, please enjoy all the sessions have a wonderful time. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Rolly Keating, and Jamie Stewart, John Conrad, and B from the British Library. And our supporters, the British Asian Trust, British Council, India, and LSE South Asia Centre. In case you missed some of our earlier sessions, including From Salaam Bombay to A Suitable Boy, Meera Nair in conversation, and The Silk Roads, Peter Frankopan in conversation with William Dalrymple, you can find these on our Facebook page, JLF Litfest, or on our YouTube channel, Jaipur Litfest JLF. Do remember to block your dates for JLF London at the British Library, 11th to the 13th of September, 2020. Our first session today on JLF London at the British Library is Myth and Memory. The social and political realities of modern India can be effectively understood through its living epics, which are constantly reinterpreted to reflect the collective imagination of its people. Writers Amish and Namita Gokhale discuss the intersections of myth, memory, and culture in the context of their writing. Amish is an author and columnist and recently turned diplomat. He took over as the director of the Nehru Center in London in October 2019. Amish was listed among the 50 most powerful Indians by India Today magazine in 2019. His books have sold over 5.5 million copies and have been translated into 10 Indian and 9 international languages. Namita Gokhale is an award-winning writer and publisher. She is the author of 19 books, including 10 works of fiction. Her latest novel, Jaipur Journals, set against the backdrop of the world's largest literary gathering, was released in January 2020 to rave reviews. Namita Gokhale is also co-founder director of the Jaipur Literature Festival. Please do remember to comment and ask questions by typing it into the comment section. And in case any of you drop off due to bandwidth issues, you can find us on our YouTube channel, Jaipur Litfest JLF. And of course, if we drop off, just hang in there. We'll be right back. Ladies and gentlemen, Myth and Memory, Amish and Namita Gokhale in conversation.
Hello, Amish.
Hi, Havita. How are you? An absolute pleasure to meet you again, or at least online.
Well, I was looking forward to being in London for our actual session, but I guess that will happen a little later. And this is a wonderful, wonderful opportunity to catch up with you on the subject which both of us share such a deep interest in. I've written on it, and you, of course, have constructed a whole new attitude towards it among the millennials. So, and my only fear today is that now that you're a newly minted diplomat, though always very diplomatic, don't be too diplomatic in your reply.
I hope you don't want to get me fired from my job.
keep, let's, you know. We have Lord Shiva protecting you. So, you know, I'd like to tell some of our international audiences who are watching that I will try to keep this as open to those people who are not familiar to the nuances of Indian myths, because Indian myth pervades every aspect of our everyday lives, from television to advertising to politics to indeed school-going children. There's nothing that doesn't come into its ambit and its purview. Now, somebody once described India as a python, an ajgar, with its tail in medieval times and its head in the next century. Our collective memories and identities are indeed rooted in the distant past. So how do you view these intersections of myth, history, and religion, Amish? How do they reflect in your work as well as in your personal belief system?
Fantastic question. And Namita, it's interesting you should use that example of, you know, of a python. There's this book, a Marathi book called Muslim Anatha Shodh, which was written by Sheshrao More. And he had described Hindu society pretty much actually like that, Hindu society. And in that, he didn't use the term Hindu just for the modern term Hinduism. He used it for all dharmic paths, you know, which is Hinduism, Buddhism, Jainism, Sikhism, all of which have dharma as the foundation. And he had spoken of our attitude to life, and he had actually compared it to a python, that it's not an aggressive culture. It doesn't go out to seek conquest over the other lands, but it has an ability to assimilate what comes to our land. It's a very
that's
interesting
thing. As it ingests.
Yeah. Not exactly like a python. So maybe that example should be taken with a pinch of salt. But the key thing of India is we are the only pre-Bronze Age culture which is still a living culture today. Every other pre-Bronze Age culture has been wiped out. And this is something that I think in modern India, we don't study enough. You know, perhaps the real India has still not made inroads into academia, you know, so that these issues can actually be discussed from a real Indian, from a rooted perspective. Both you and I have spoken often of the real India and our attitudes, you know, to life. But I think, you know, some of the things which impact real India and why our myths are so important, because these stories are so old. You know, there's this wonderful line I'd heard once that no Indian hears the Ramayana for the first time. We are born with it, right? Because no culture is as ancient as us and still alive today. You know, the Sri Rudram was written much before even the pyramids were built in Egypt. And Indians today still chant the Sri Rudram. You know, that is how ancient our culture is. And I think part of why, there are various reasons for why we have remained alive, whereas many other ancient cultures have died out. But I think part of it is that in India, we don't privilege texts over folk traditions. Unlike, say, in the Middle Eastern or the Western traditions, where texts are clearly considered superior, you know, the text or the one book is clearly considered superior to folk traditions. In India, there's a lovely Sanskrit line, Shastrat Rudir Balyasi, that folk traditions are as powerful, if not more powerful, than the texts. And I think if myths and stories become that deep, that the common people make it their own, that they have the right to interpret it the way they want to, then their hearts are associated with it, then it doesn't die, right? Because texts can become, you know, perhaps a little distant at times, right? Especially when an elite comes in and tries to make it classical culture. And in India, I think that's one of the strengths that India has had. We have never privileged texts over folk traditions. You had a wonderful book on Goddess Sita, where you explored many of the folk traditions around Goddess Sita as well. We don't just know Goddess Sita and the Ramayana through the traditional texts, we know them through the folk traditions as well. That's what keeps it so real for us. I think that's one of the reasons why our culture is, to use, you know, Nassim Taleb's term, anti-fragile.
So you answered a bit of my next question, but not all of it, which is that myths in most cultures remain static of the past, though it may be interpreted in the present. Yet the Indic cultures renegotiate its relationship with its collective myths in every generation through poetry, television, films, and scholarly interpretation, as has happened with Sita after my book, your book.
Yeah.
The folk attitude, which was critical sometimes of the patriarchal treatment of Sita, got the primary attention. And that's what keeps these myths alive and relevant, because they are brought to life with every reader, every viewer, every grandmother's age listener. You have contributed vastly to this process by reintroducing that most enigmatic of Indian gods, the Lord Shiva, god of life and death, to very millennials and to a new generation through the Meluha trilogy. Tell us more about this, because I know how much trouble you had in selling that book to publishers and how it went on to shake the very foundations of the Indian publishing industry. And when it came out, I remember in those days when one still went on flights, when I was frequently on flights, I would often see half the people on a flight immersed in the Madhuha trilogy. So what did that do, the Book of Shiva, to readers? What did it awaken in them? What did it transform in them?
I don't know if it will be correct for me to analyze the impact my books have had, but let me see it from another perspective. I think part of the reason why my books were rejected, by many publishers that were sent to, is also the assumption that such books wouldn't sell in the English language, and perhaps that was based in reality because such books weren't selling in big numbers. The kind of books that were selling, would be campus romance novels or office politics novels or things like that. And my books were relatively long, they're 400-500 pages on average. My books, one of the publishers who rejected it told me that you have these gyan sessions every 2-3 chapters, because for me, my books are, they're not just stories. I follow the Indian traditions in that sense, that the stories are a wrapper for some philosophies you want to convey. So I like to discuss those philosophies every second or third chapter. So they said this is a guaranteed flop. It's not going to work. And I think perhaps what is happening in India post 1991, and I was just lucky to be there in the right place at the right time. As you and I have discussed often, it has been discussed earlier, these stories are part of the Indian way of life. It's a part of our bones, part of our genes. But one part of the tradition that we had forgotten, perhaps in the last few centuries, was the ability to reinterpret these stories and see them in a new light. We had fallen into the Western paradigm of just seeing the texts as they were written a few centuries ago. I think what happened post 1991, as India became, post the economic reforms of 1991, as India became richer and started experiencing success again after centuries of decline, our ancient attitudes got revived. As self-confidence returns, you're willing to look at yourself with a new eye. And I think I was just lucky that my books happened to be launched at this time. For all you know, if my books had been launched 40 years ago, maybe it wouldn't have done that way. So I think this, I don't see it as a new India. I see it as the real India rediscovering itself and rediscovering its old traditions, where our ancient traditions are actually in line with liberalism, that where we are open to multiple truths. This is what our ancient culture was. And I'm just damn lucky that my books happened to be launched as at the time when society was perhaps changing in that direction.
So you've spoken to me a few times in private conversations about your grandfather. And you were just talking about Gyan. So Gyan for international audiences is indeed sort of given knowledge, divine knowledge. So what is the Gyan you got from your grandfather? What are your memories of him and your immersive early experiences? Because I always love to hear or remember what you once told me fleetingly, but it stayed with me.
Yeah, he was, my grandfather was a pandit, in Kashi, in Banaras.
And he was an ordained priest?
No. Yes. He was a priest. But in our tradition, there is no church which kind of ordains you as a priest. You learn the texts and you do the puja. So that's how he was. He had lost his mother at a very young age. He lost his father when he was a teenager. So he was practically an orphan. He benefited greatly from the charity of Madan Mohan Malviyaji, who was the founder of the Banaras Hindu University. Not that Madan Mohan Malviyaji was specifically looking after my grandfather. He just had a charity program for poor, talented people. And my grandfather happened to be one of the children who benefited from it. He was, you'll understand this, you're an Indian. Saraswati Maa ki bahut kripa thi, Lakshmi Maa ki itni kripa nahi thi. So, Saraswati Maa is the goddess of knowledge. Lakshmi Ma, for those who don't know, the goddess Lakshmi is the goddess of wealth. So my grandfather had a lot of blessings of the goddess of knowledge, almost no blessings from the goddess of wealth. But we grew up in that atmosphere, you know, deep in our traditions. My grandfather was deeply liberal because he knew our ancient texts. He used to always say, you know, that the more you read our texts, the more liberal you'll become. You know, so for example, he had 8 children, 5 daughters, 3 sons. And in those days, no one used to educate their daughters. He educated all his daughters. My eldest boa, who's 90 plus, is a medical doctor. In her 5 years of medical, she was the only woman in there. And Babaji, my grandfather, was deeply devoted to our traditions, and one learned a lot from him, you know. And one of the memories that I always treasure, I remember whenever I used to go to Banaras, and we used to go regularly every few months, every Sunday Babaji used to take the 4 of us siblings, you know, and carry the Ramcharitmanas. We're a Lord Shiva, we're a Shaivite family, but he was a devotee of Lord Ram as well. He carried the Ramcharitmanas, go to the Tulsi Ghat next to the Gangaji River, and he would actually sit out there, read 2 or 3 pages and explain the text for free to people who would gather around. You know, and then I remember then he would just gather it up and we'd go back holding hands, and he usually used to buy some milk, you know, on the way back home. And we used to always ask him, why do you do this? And he used to keep saying that if you've been blessed with knowledge, it is your duty to share it as much as you can, and ideally share it free, because knowledge increases as you share it more. That was his attitude, and that was a wonderful culture he built in our family.
So you grew up with a deep background of the subjects you wrote about. You didn't have to study them or research them.
No.
In that sense.
It's just good luck.
My next question is about the 2 ancient epics, the Ramayana and the Mahabharata, which really are the foundational epics of India. And indeed, that India, which is Bharat, draws its name from the Mahabharata. You have worked extensively on the Ramayana through your interpretation of Ram and Sita in the Ikshvaku trilogy. Have you also studied the Mahabharata, which is a much more secular text or a much more pragmatic text? And has it also been, except that, of course, for the Bhagavad Gita being a part of it, and has it been a source of inspiration, or will it feature in a future book?
No, it certainly will. I certainly do hope to write on the Mahabharata, you know, as well over time. You know, I'd love to hear your take on Goddess Sita as well. You're right. On the Ramayana also, one gets to know so many different interpretations. There is an ancient interpretation called the Adbhut Ramayana, credited to Valmiki ji, the original author, in which Goddess Sita killed Ram. It's a very, you know, empowering edition. In the Mahabharata, I think, you know, it's, I don't know if I'd use the word secular. Secular is a very modern concept, because it is in opposition to religion, which is about faith. In ancient India, dharma is not about faith, actually. You could be an atheist and still be a, you know, Hindu or a Buddhist or a Jain. Many of our 12, depending on how you count it, 12 or 13 schools of philosophy of the 4 religions of Hinduism, Buddhism, Jainism, Sikhism, it can be divided into so many schools of philosophy. Of these, 5 are actually atheist schools. They don't believe in a creator god. Sankhya, Mimamsa, Charvak, Bodha, Jaina, they don't believe in a creator god. So they are, from the modern perspective, they are atheists, but they were still Hindu, dharmic, right? So dharma was present in both Ramayana and Mahabharata, but the approach was different, because in the Ramayana, Lord Ram's approach was much more maryada driven, much more right and wrong driven, where both the means and the ends had to be good. Whereas the Mahabharata was often a little more nuanced, where the ends justified the means. So the approach was different. And what is interesting is the way the Valmiki Ramayana and Mahabharata are written is also different. The Valmiki Ramayana is very poetic. You can actually get lost in the wonderful turn of phrase that Valmiki ji had. You know, many of the way Valmiki ji described, You know, for example, when Lord Ram was waiting to cross over into Lanka for the battle, Valmiki, and it was the monsoon season. Valmiki ji described how the cloud came. Kalidasa, who would have written it, would have written his Meghadutam play 1,000 or 2,000 years later, used the same turn of phrase that Valmiki ji used, right? So Valmiki ji was very poetic, right? Whereas Ved Vyas ji, who wrote the Mahabharat, who composed the Mahabharat, was much more efficient. It was not about beautiful turn of phrase. His objective was very clear. I need to convey philosophies. I need to convey them in as clear a language as possible. So keep the language efficient and simple. Focus on the philosophies. Whereas Valmiki ji spent a lot more time on the poetry, you know, of it. So me, I've been influenced by both texts, right? My writing style is more influenced by Ved Vyas ji. I'm more about communicating the philosophies rather than getting into poetry. But I think there is nuance in the Ramayana as well. And that perhaps needs to be conveyed. That's what I try and do in the Ramchandra series. So I know it's a long-winded answer, but what I guess I'm trying to say is, like every Indian, I am deeply influenced by the Ramayana and the Mahabharata as well. Like every Indian, I can say, perhaps I was just born with it. Or most of all of us Indians are just, regardless of religion, caste, language, we are born with this in our genes, in our bones. So I'm deeply influenced by the Ramayana and the Mahabharata. And I'd love to hear your take on Bodhisattva, because I know you've done a wonderful book on it.
I edited this anthology called In Search of Sita, which was a sort of starting point to understanding what I thought was the collective wounding that followed a certain sort of injustice done to her. But I'll come to that in my next question. Here, I just want to tell you about my experience about writing the Mahabharata for young readers in the Puffin Mahabharata, one of the most stable sort of, I won't say bestseller, but it goes on year after year. And I rashly agreed to do this, write it in 40,000 words for young and first-time readers. I completed it in 2 years. And after that, for 3 years, I couldn't write anything. I was just so stunned by all that I had read. I said, all the stories in the world have been written. Why am I wasting everybody's time by trying to tell any new stories? And thereafter, so many of the stories that I did write, even if they were contemporary, found their reflection in the Mahabharata. So talking about Sita and me and Dr. Malashri Lal and our anthology, we looked at whether a patriarchal society had been less than fair to Sita. I would like to talk to you about, I'd like to go back to Lord Shiva. The god Shiva is depicted as a composite androgynous figure, with left side represented by the goddess Parvati, his wife. Yeah, and the feminine deities in the Indian pantheon are strong and inspiring. Right. Yet, I sense a very disturbing hyper-masculinity, very hyper-masculine interpretations entering religious discourse. Do you think this will play out? Will the divine feminine reassert herself? Or do you think we will become a more and more of a patriarchal society? Not a society, but a patriarchal mythology. A lot of the old mythologies around the world had the goddess figures erased bit by bit. Sita has reasserted herself enormously in literature and poetry and film in the last few years. I've just done a book on Radha, the goddess Radha, Lord Krishna. But what do
you haven't read that? I should check it out.
I will send you a copy. This is my question. Will the divine feminine reassert herself, or will this disturbing hyper-masculinity that has entered religious discourse play out? And how to counter it?
In the Indian way, let me give a slightly nuanced answer to this. One of the things you'll find is that most societies which suffer random violence for very long tend to become patriarchal over time, especially if a society suffers repeated random violence. India suffered invasions over the last 1,000 years, as did the Arab world actually. Over the last 800, 900 years, same people who attacked us attacked the Arab world as well. And much of Eastern Europe as well. And I think that ended up reflecting in our, in the mythology and the stories that were written in the medieval era, in the last millennium. One of the interesting things you find is that if you go into the more ancient texts, they are actually deeply equal. So, for example, the Rig Veda, which is the oldest, Indian scripture, has many hymns written by rishis, of course, who were the equivalents of the prophets and messiahs of the Abrahamic faiths. But the Rig Veda also has hymns written by rishikas, yes, by women rishis. And Namita, you are aware of our text, so you know this.
11 rishikas.
Maharishika Gargi, Maharishika Maitreyi, and the status of the rishis and rishikas were higher than the status of kings and queens. So we had the equivalent of women prophets and messiahs in ancient India. We had women rulers like Prabhavati Gupta, for example, the Vakataka ruler, who used to rule in their name, not as a regent, in their name, or Rudrama Devi, for example. Many of these traditions fell in decline, and especially over the last 1,000 years with the invasions. And my submission always, I always say this publicly, and I've said it publicly often in India, that we have no excuses anymore. We've been at peace for 70 years. We've been free for 70 years. And this is the time then to revive our ancient traditions. Our ancient texts which said that the gods abandoned the land where women are not respected. This is what our ancient texts say. We need to revive those traditions. Then when it comes to the question of aggressive masculinity and the sacred feminine, you're absolutely right. Lord Shiva is shown often in his Ardhanarishwar form, which is half female, half male. And there's a wonderful story behind that as well. I won't go into the full details, but there was a devotee who said that he is only a devotee of Lord Shiva and not of his wife, Goddess Parvati. So he would pray only to him, to Lord Shiva. And Lord Shiva said, if you pray to me, my wife is my equal, you have to pray to her as well. And the devotee said, no, my Lord, I only worship you. And in response to that, Lord Shiva had said, my wife and I are one, and Goddess Parvati and he had become one body. He said that we are one, don't you dare try to separate us. And there's a very deep message in that to all Lord Shiva devotees, that that we worship Lord Shiva and we worship Goddess Parvati as equals. Now, Goddess Parvati, of course, represents the sacred feminine. But if you see Lord Shiva in his Rudra Roop, in his angry Roop, boss, he's as masculine and fearsome as he can be, as anyone can be. He's powerful, virile, strong, a brilliant warrior, right? So I think that is the balance that one must find. That there has to be respect for the strong masculine and the strong feminine. If the strong masculine becomes the toxic masculine, that is negative, right? And what keeps the strong masculine balanced? I believe it is about dharma. You may be a follower of the strong masculine way of life. Men, some, and many women do follow the strong masculine way of life. But you must have the curbs of dharma. And dharma means that which is right, right? If you have that, you will never become toxic. Then you can have balance between both Goddess Parvati and Lord Shiva. Because there's a corollary to this story as well, where Lord Shiva told his devotee that you will worship me and my wife as equal. There are devotees of Goddess Parvati too, who said, we will only worship you. We will not worship Lord Shiva. And Goddess Parvati had also said, if you worship me, you'll worship my husband too as an equal. So Goddess Parvati had the same message, that the sacred feminine and the sacred masculine, if they are in partnership, bound by dharma, that is the ideal state.
Well, the Indian goddesses can be ugra and very, very angry as well.
Oh, yeah.
I hope we don't have a lot of very angry goddesses coming around to us. Just to move out of Indian myth a little bit, myth, legend, they travel, they converge. For example, the Indian god of fire, Mitra, comes from Persia, wearing his signature boots, and the Devas and the Asuras and all these stories also come from Central Asia. And what are the myths around the world from different cultures that draw you and hold your interest?
Various things. Yeah. So, you know, there are various traditions. There are some who say that Lord Mitra came from the Zoroastrian Persian traditions. There are some who say that Lord Mitra is a Vedic god, because Lord Mitra and Lord Varun have been mentioned together in the Rig Veda. And Avastan and old Sanskrit are kind of, you know, cousin languages. It's a very interesting, and, you know, and the way I see it, getting into a debate of where, you know, the philosophies came from is pointless. One should revel in the beauty of the philosophy and, you know, learn from it. You know, Mithraism had, you know, traveled all the way to Rome as well. Many people don't know this. There was a time, especially during Emperor Vespasian's time, if I'm not mistaken, where much of the Roman military used to actually practice Mithraism. So, and even the tradition of Sol Invictus was in some ways related to Mithraism. And there are some historians who say that the tradition of Sol Invictus then became the story of the birth of Jesus Christ. You know, stories travel, you know, and the beauty is the interpretations change. And, you know, the root of the word mythology is a Greek word called mythos. And I traveled to Greece many years ago, and I'd asked a Greek person this, that what do the Greeks think mythos means? And because the dictionary has a very derogatory meaning to mythos. Some, you know, a fanciful story may have had some elements of truth, but usually full of nonsense. That's how the dictionary, I'm not saying they use the word nonsense in there, but it's a derogatory approach to mythos. Whereas that Greek woman I'd asked told me a beautiful interpretation that the Greeks had. She said that according to her, mythos means a story which hides the philosophical truth. So what is important is not the story. What is important is through that story, discover the philosophical truth. That is the true purpose. And if we can do that, then the story has served its purpose, because our task with that is to learn that philosophy and then apply it in our own life. That's the true purpose of mythology.
What about other mythologies, Norse mythology, any others of those that reach out to you especially?
Many. I have read much on ancient Hellenic, that's Greek mythology. I have read a lot on Egyptian mythology. Egypt is the term that we use for it. The Egyptians call themselves Khem. That was apparently their own name. The word Egypt comes from the Greek word for Egypt, Aegyptos, which got anglicized to Egypt. So if you read the Khem mythology and philosophy, the stories of Osiris, Isis, Seth, Horus, I mean, they're wonderfully deep. The Greek, Hellenic theology, the myths of Gilgamesh, of Mesopotamia, so I suggest this to many Indians. We should explore all these stories, and you find surprising, connections and similarities, and especially since India is a surviving ancient culture. So if we study many of these ancient mythologies of Egypt, Greece, the Norse gods, Celts, we find many philosophies which connect to us at a very deep level.
The Icelandic myths also with the great cow. It's fascinating.
And I've heard of it.
Writing stories around these myths, do they come to you as well?
I have a story in mind based on Egyptian mythology. The problem for me is I have too many story ideas. I at least have some 20-25 ideas for series, not books, series already in my mind. I've left clues for many of them in the Shiva trilogy and Ramchand series. My hardcore readers have decoded many of those clues. My biggest problem is I don't want to die before I finish all my stories. I can't carry them to my cremation pyre.
Well,
I'm not the moksha.
Bachcha, you will have to live to be 1,000 years. Wish you all that. But I hope you're using the pandemic well.
Yeah, I'm writing. I'm 20,000 words down into the fourth book of the Ramchandra series. Yeah.
So I'm now going to ask you, let's move back to who you are. You were a regular Mumbai boy who grew up in a cosmopolitan atmosphere in towns and cities across India before you began a successful professional life as a banker. I remember you telling me you were in a pop group and you used to play the guitar or something like that.
Yeah. I was the lead singer of our band, yeah.
Singer? What made you switch tracks to begin a parallel career writing about figures from myth and religion? And then the next movement as a diplomat, representing the Indian government at London's prestigious Nehru Center. Where among all these selves is the essential Amish? Where do you reside? In London, but I mean in your core identity.
I think, you know, life is what happens to you while you're planning for other things. If someone had told me 15 years ago that I'd be a full-time writer, I would have laughed at the guy, right? I wrote my first two books along with my job. I resigned only after my second book when my royalty check became more than my salary. It was a very pragmatic decision. But when I was writing only for myself. I really wasn't thinking, where these books will go. I wasn't even thinking about whether the books would get published. I was genuinely writing for myself. And life just took me in this direction. And even this role, this diplomatic role, I am, deeply proud of our ancient culture, of Indian culture. I think India has something to add to the global conversation at this point of time. I think our wonderful mix of traditions and liberalism, and the sense of the balance that is a part of the ancient Indian way, we need to speak of that within India and we need to speak of that outside India as well. I think it can help the modern world. So therefore, since I was enthusiastic about it when this opportunity came, I thought, yeah, this would be an opportunity worth exploring and, maybe I can contribute something. But these are all the things that have happened to me and who I am essentially. I'm essentially defined by three identities. I'm a very, very proud father to a wonderful 11-year-old boy called Neil. I'm a very, very proud Indian. And I'm a very, very proud Lord Shiva devotee. These are my three primary identities.
So I'm a very nervous interviewer and I've listed out my questions and you've already answered my next question, which was, I was saying that, Indian myth is so immersive that it involves a certain kind of surrender to enter it and to understand its parallel realities, which is not always easy to explain to people who have not been brought up with this sort of worldview of thinking always that there are so many parallel realities which we can inhabit, parallel realities, often conflicting realities.
Right.
And in this very experiential religion, which draws from an intensity of personal belief, tell us about your visualization, I was saying, of Shiva, of Rama, of Sita. But you have said you're a Shiva devotee. So let's sort of, before we move to the questions, tell me how you see Lord Shiva, God of life and death. So I've also written a book on Shiva called Shiva. So I have, and I'm from the mountains where Shiva is there in every stone and pebble. So what Shiva means to you?
Yeah, you're from Uttarakhand, which by many Indians call it Devabhumi, the land of the gods. Lord Shiva, I think in my mind, what makes him so attractive is he's the Lord of contradictions in many ways. He's the God of contradictions. He is the Lord of the arts. He's called the Nataraj, God of dance. He is the God of music, which makes him in some senses an elite God, right? Because it's elitist pursuit to pursue arts and Lord Shiva is the God of the arts. But at the same time, there is this lovely term in North India, Shivji ki Barat, right? That the wedding procession of Lord Shiva, which anyone can join. There were no restrictions. Right, Lord Shiva doesn't differentiate.
Goblins, if I remember.
Anyone can join. Lord Shiva doesn't differentiate between the highborn and the lowborn, doesn't differentiate between men and women, doesn't differentiate between your any preferences you may have, transgender, anyone, it does not matter. Whether you are devoted to him or not devoted to him, even that does not matter. Right? Anyone can come to him. He's in that sense the god of the masses. But with his arts, he's also the god of the elite. He's not what you'd call a sharp dresser, right? I mean, he has cremation ash on his body. He wears a tiger skin skirt. But in one of his forms, he can be Lord Sundareshwar as well. You know, when he went for his wedding to Goddess Parvati, he was very, very beautiful, very good looking. And he went in a very good looking form. He is the lord of detachment. He is very calm. He is the god of yoga. He is the originator of yoga, which at its core is about breathing, calm, you know, finding balance within yourself. But he also has a very fearsome temper, right? In his Rudra angry rope. If you think, many of these are deeply contradictory, right? And I'd written an article once on this subject, that I think Lord Shiva is contradictory because he actually in a way balances us. Those of us who are naturally a little anti-elitist, as I am, right, will get attracted to him and then learn to appreciate the finer points of art as well, and perhaps then learn to appreciate that there's some good in the elite as well, right? Those of us who are very elitist may come to Lord Shiva because of the arts, and then realize Lord Shiva doesn't differentiate between the highborn and the lowborn. So perhaps they should also not differentiate. Those who are hyper-masculine, you know, as we were just speaking of, will get attracted to Lord Shiva's warrior form. But when they come close to him, they will realize he treats his wife as an complete equal. So which means they should learn that too. So there is this thing, I think, that because he's so contradictory, he manages to attract people on both sides of the spectrum, and then he balances them. And divinity is in that Madhyam Marga, on the middle path, in that balance. And he serves that purpose. That's what makes him so attractive, I think. That's why he generates that immense passion. No disrespect to any other god or goddess, but that's why Lord Shiva just generates that immense passion, you know, that his devotees have for him.
I'd just like to add to what you said here before we move on to the questions. You said that Lord Shiva treats his wife as an equal. I mean, I don't think that is quite enough. In fact, it is said that Shiva without Shakti,
is a shav, you're right.
And also, I think the Shakti of Shiva is even superior to Shiva, and the feminine is stronger in Shiva than the masculine. The other point I'd like to you to touch on briefly for our audiences is how he is both the god of death and life, and how this god of death, being the primary god of this religion and culture, how that fits in with his being the priapic form of life as well.
Yeah,
the god of death.
I think, Namita, you said something so wise earlier, that you know that the Indian worldview itself is fundamentally different as compared to the West or many other people who may have joined in.
Every culture is unique in itself. So
But India, because it's so ancient, and one of the things that's different is the way time is seen, where India is different from, and I'm not saying it's better or worse, it's just it's different. In India, time is seen as circular. It's not a straight line. There's no beginning, middle, end. Because in a circle, there is no beginning, there is no end. Right? And which is why in India, you'll find the word for yesterday and tomorrow is the same. Kal. Kal can be used for yesterday also. It can be used for tomorrow also. And if you see it from this perspective, then you'll see that one of the beliefs in the Indian way is if time is circular, then there really is no death. There's just transformation. You know, nothing truly escapes the universe. You just change form. what is death for one form is the creation of another form. So then the God who is in a way the, it's not, it will be half the truth to see him as the God of destruction, because he's the other moment of destruction as well, which is creation. So in a sense, he is the God of transformation. Nothing truly dies in the universe.
I think, yes, it's just God of transformation.
Exactly. It just changes form. Nothing ever escapes the universe. You just, one form dies, and immediately on the other moment, another form is created. The death of one form is the creation of another. So you just change form. You don't actually die. That's one of the perspectives in the Indian way. So then, therefore, Lord Shiva is the God of transformation.
So on that note, let me begin on some of the very wise questions coming in. Sachdev Ramakrishna asks, you speak of some foundational concepts in our historical myths, such as dharma. What may be some of these concepts to embrace to cope with modern day issues? So what is your understanding of the word dharma, really? And maybe the conflict of dharma sometimes.
Difficult to answer this, you know, in such a short time, because our ancestors have debated dharma for millennia. Look, the root of the word dharma is dhru. Dhru is that which binds, that which balances, that which holds things together. So dharma is that which balances the world, balances the universe, balances our life. Adharma is that which unbalances the world. So therefore, you know, I think the best way to see dharma is what brings balance in your lives and in society. So for example, in the modern day, and I think perhaps there's no better time than this COVID pandemic, to step back and take a relook at our modern day life, there is no doubt that the consumerism of the last century has created a lot of good, no doubt. Many people have been pulled out of poverty. On a per capita basis, this is perhaps the richest that humanity has ever been. Middle classes today lead lifestyles that even royal families couldn't have lived 150 years ago. So there has been some positives out of this consumerism. I will not deny that. But is there an excess of this consumerism? And are we causing too much damage to Mother Nature? Now, if we think of dharma, then we will think of perhaps rebalancing our lives. That there should be consumerism. It is good for humans. It reduces poverty. There is no doubt in that. But can we be balanced in our consumerism? Can we control the excess? Because one of the things you will find with adharma is that you lose a sense of peace. You find so many people who are very consumerist, but they aren't happy. They don't find peace, right? They keep searching for the next brand to buy. So this is one of the things that could be addressed with dharma. There are so many things that essentially try and find balance in your life, and balance will give you dharma.
I think there's one more question. I don't know how much time we have, but this is a very sweet question. Aruna Dasgupta asks, I find your use of G when you refer to Ved Vyas and Valmiki very endearing and appealing. Is this part of your Babaji's legacy? Would you use it when referring to contemporary authors?
I don't know. I mean, that's, you know, the bizarre thing is, like most of us Indians, we have two or three languages within us, right? And each language is not just a language, it's an entire way of life. I notice that when I speak in Hindi, I always say Ganga Ji. I never say Ganga River. It doesn't even come consciously. It's just a part of my upbringing. So, I am who I am. I just tend to go instinctively. So maybe the people meet in the UK, I might not overuse the word G, but in India, yes, I tend to.
Nice. I think, I'm not sure if we have time for another question or whether, we are supposed to bind up now. I think we can have a last question.
Right.
And would like to ask you this, that what are your literary inspirations? The writers, we've talked enough of the ancient texts. Hmm. So don't tell me Valmiki Ji and Ved Vyas Ji.
And you talk about modern writers.
Namita ji either.
I think you'll slap me if I say Namita ji.
Well, that's not giving people a very good sort of impression of yourself.
No, I'm joking.
You're safe on the other end of Zoom, but who are indeed, I can see a lot of books behind you. What are the books in your bookshelf? What are your literary inspirations? What are you reading in this great cosmopolitan literary city of London?
You know, I read a lot, you know that. I read at least 5-6 books a month. And I normally read nonfiction. And I always say that if you have only one or two authors who've inspired you, then you haven't read enough. You must read more. So how I normally answer this question is that of the books I've read in the recent past, which ones have I liked? So there is this book written by Pawan Varma, a brilliant IFS officer, brilliant diplomat, Ambassador Pawan Varma. And he's written this book called The Greatest Ode to Lord Ram. It's based on the Ramcharitmanas, which was written by Goswami Tulsidas ji. He has picked some of the shlokas from the Ramcharitmanas and translated them and given a commentary on them. So you get a deeper understanding of what is behind those dohas, those shlokas. And it's a wonderful book and a great way to get introduced to the Ramcharitmanas. So I'd strongly recommend that book. I think it's been released recently, just a month and a half or 2 months back, The Greatest Ode to Lord Ram by Ambassador Pawan Varma.
No Dan Brown?
Sorry?
No Dan Brown, no thrillers, no speculative fiction?
No, I love fiction as well. So I had read Ashwin Sanghi's World of Vishnu recently. Oh, I love the book. Ashwin Sanghi is a dear friend. And, he has this wonderful way of marrying ancient knowledge and modern conspiracy theories and putting it in a real kick-ass fast-paced page-turner type story. And he's done a brilliant job with the World of Vishnu, Ashwin Sanghi. I strongly recommend that book too. That's also been released recently, just a few months back.
So I guess that we have to have more of these sessions at the Nehru Center presenting Indian writing. And on that note, thank you very, very, very much, Amish. I hope we see you soon in London. And over to you, Sanjoy.
Namita ji, Amish ji, aap logo mein shukraguzar kehna chahunga. Thank you so much, Amish.
Sanjoy ji, Hindi mein vartalaap kar rahe hain. Wah!
Amit sort of said that I must wrap it up in Hindi. So thank you all so much. And this conversation could have gone on forever. And thank you for all the questions. And I'm sorry we couldn't take so many of them because we've just run out of time. But I'm sure if we send them on to Namita and Amish, they will be both happy to answer them and we'll post them back on Facebook, etc. Thank you all for watching and being, as usual, such an amazing audience. We hope you enjoyed the conversation and you will log back at 4:30 p.m. British Summer Time and 9 p.m. Indian Standard Time for our next session. Follow the Science. Nobel laureate Venki Ramakrishnan speaks to Roger Highfield of the importance of scientific thinking of medical research and breakthrough technologies to combat the current crisis and better prepare for future pandemics. For those of you who've loved JLF London at the British Library, please do log in to view JLF's Brave New World online series featuring some of the best writers from across the world. Here's a preview.
Exhilarating ride to watch the JLF Brave New World find its voice, find its audience.
It's kind of silver lining in the dark clouds of this terrible pandemic that with authors stuck at home and with listeners stuck at home, we've been able to persuade many of the world's very greatest writers to come and give us half an hour of their time and to come and speak to you guys at home on your phones or on your screens.
JLF's Brave New World, where we will bring together writers, thinkers, and innovators from across the world to be able to decipher the past, to make sense of the present, and envision a better future.
We were desperately unprepared. We were caught by surprise, although we should not have been caught by surprise.
As an infectious disease specialist, I've treated many different types of infections over the years, including, you know, unusual tropical infections from imported from various places around the world. But I've never known a clinical syndrome like COVID.
All of the, at least COVID-related healthcare should be made free.
That the best solution would be one where you have strong decentralization of authority coupled with effective coordination at the national level, and the same would apply globally.
And we will need to reallocate resources from sectors that will not return to sectors that are growing.
Probably the silliest thing anyone could do right now is sit down and write their coronavirus novel.
I am not that utilitarian. Say there is a revolution, there is an earthquake, there is a pandemic, there is a grave political situation, people are suffering, and they say, well, what's the rules of use of literature?
And I think literature remains the best way, the key, the most inspiring key, if you will, to be able to understand, to decode, and to endure what is happening.
We grow up with language absolutely as part of our living and breathing.
There's one main rule, and that is you have to get the reader interested in what you're writing.
Well, the only living things that have the intelligence and sensitivity to appreciate the wonders of nature.
As always, our sessions end with soulful melodies of world music from our Jaipur music stage. We present Purbayan Chatterjee, the recipient of several prestigious awards, and he's an acclaimed sitar maestro. He belongs to the Senia Maihar Gharana, founded by Baba Alauddin Khan Saab, the guru of Pandit Ravi Shankar and Ali Akbar Khan Saab. His music is a treat for the ears. Enjoy and see you back shortly. Thank you.
Thank you.